out of the right hand of Jordy Ball, the All-American for Oklahoma, against Kiki Malloy, the nation's home run leader for the Tennessee Lady Vols. Both were winners in their first games a couple days ago. The winner of this one advances to Monday's national semifinals and would be one win away from the championship series. I'm Beth Mowens, along with our Olympic gold medalist Jessica Mendoza, with the 38 home runs and 114 runs batted in.
That's what makes it so good, the fact that Kiki Malloy, the best player here in Oklahoma City, but on deck, Zeta Pudi, so powerful. Gotta give Malloy good pitches.
Adding to the intrigue, both Zeta Pudi and the starting shortstop Mackenzie Donahue transferred in from Oklahoma. And right down the line inside of third base. And the stand-up double for Kiki Malloy to open things up for Tennessee.
0-2 pitch. Kiki Malloy. And this is a changeup. And definitely left up and middle. 57 miles an hour. And you think about the velocity of Jordy Ball, but with 0-2, Kiki Malloy just gets enough. This is how strong she is. Not full power down the line. And the pumped up getting a leadoff batter with a double for Tennessee.
12th double of the year. She's got 25 home runs. So much power in that leadoff position for Kiki Malloy.
Here is Zeta Pudi. As we check out Jordy Ball, the two-time All-American and the pitcher of the year this year in the Big 12 Conference out of Papillion, Nebraska at 19-1. That one loss significant because it is the only loss of the season for Oklahoma. They are 57-1, and that loss came 104 days ago. They are on pace right now to have the best season in softball history in terms of record, fewest losses, and win percentage for Patty Gasso, now in her 29th season and a holder of 6 national championship trophies, 5 of those coming in the last 9 years. Another 0-2 pitch to Pudi, and the rise is upstairs. This is the streak that Oklahoma is on. It is a new NCAA record. 49 wins in a row, 21 of those coming against ranked opponents. Over half of them have been shutouts, including their 2-0 win over Stanford in their opening round game here in OKC.
And how about 12 of those games, they've scored 10-plus runs.
And a called strike 3 on the outside corner, one down.
Jordy Ball expanding the zone on an 0-2 pitch. That's an off-speed curveball. She throws that at about 59 miles an hour. Look at the way it's spinning. It's going to slide off the plate. And Zeta Pudi thinks this is outside. Looks like it's caught out in the river. But you know what the best part of that is for Sooner fans is that Kinzie Hansen is one of the best in the game at stealing strikes and bringing them back into the zone, helping out her pitcher.
The number 3 batter, Boo Gibson for Tennessee. Yeah, this battery of Ball and Kinzie Hansen, 2 of their 5 first-team All-Americans. They have another one at second base, at third base, and out in center field for the best defense in the country in terms of fielding percentage. Inside corner goes to 0-2 at 70 miles an hour for Jordy Ball.
There's 3 batters. She's gone 0-2.
She attacks the strike zone. And there's no doubt about it. She doesn't waste pitches. She goes right at you. You know what you're going to get.
She threw the shutout with 11 strikeouts a couple days ago against Stanford. And 2 here in the opening frame. 2 down.
Jordy Ball
can throw to all sides of the plate, but she's very good on the inner half, so she's going to attack Boo Gibson low and inside, and then she's going to expand the strike zone up with the rise ball, and you almost have no chance. You really got to look for the rotation on this ball so that you can figure out where it's going before you swing. That's a rise ball that Boo Gibson chases up and out of the zone. Here's Riley West, the number four hitter. Riley considered it, was able to check the swing. Riley was 2-for-4 the other day in Tennessee's win over Alabama. That included a three-run home run.
A smart pitch to go first pitch, because as a hitter, you're thinking, I'm swinging, she's coming. First pitch strike. Instead, she goes ball there. Riley West just held up.
Slow roll to Brio at third, and Alyssa makes the play. So the leadoff for Malloy is left out there. They are the top two scoring teams in the country. They both hit a lot of home runs. They both also have pitching staffs that don't allow a lot of home runs. Just some of the storylines here today. Beth Mowins with our Olympic gold medalist, Jessica Mendoza and Michelle Smith. We got Holly Rowe as well. Smitty, let's talk about this. Sooner Nation looking for a third national championship in a row.
Yeah, this is just a complete team. They do everything right. They're really strong in the circle, that great defense, but it's that offense. 112 home runs on the year, 110 doubles, so they can hit for power to all fields.
Well, and you think about who's going to challenge Oklahoma. That's what the question coming into this World Series. It has been the Tennessee Volunteers, the best team out of the SEC. They won the regular season. They won the SEC tournament. They also, if you looked at the numbers, they are right there behind Oklahoma. They can swing the bats. They've got a staff. And we're going to start it right now with Carlin Pickens, the freshman who's in the circle from Tennessee.
And here is the lineup that Pickens will face, brought to you by Capital Gear. There's nowhere to hide. And it starts right away with Jada Coleman and Tiare Jennings at the top. And the big story for Tennessee is the decision for Coach Karen Weekly to go with freshman Carlin Pickens as the starter today. She was terrific during the regular season, the SEC Rookie of the Year, but hit a wall late in the season. Her last few outings, not as sharp.
But that's the reason right there that she gets the start, 75 miles an hour, so she throws with elite velocity. The key, though, is to limit the free passes, 34 walks in those 83 innings.
Well, she probably saw Stanford's Nigerie Kennedy throwing 70 mile an hour plus at Oklahoma the other day, and she was able to hold him in check in a 2-0 game. But here is the big question mark. First 12, really good. The last 14 appearances, 31 earned runs allowed. So a gamble here. Let's see if it pays off for Tennessee.
And that's really the question, which Carlin Pickens is going to show up, the one that can hammer the zone at 70 plus miles an hour, the one that is outside of the zone and then has to try to figure out how to take a little bit off to come back inside and then ended up getting hit.
They have an All-American, Ashley Rogers. They have another pitcher, Peyton Gottschall, who have seen most of the innings in this second half of the season. And Holly Rowe was snooping around pregame, and Karen Weekly said, we wouldn't be shocked if we use every arm we've got today to try and mix things up as much as possible. And she gets a swing and a miss and a strikeout of Jada Coleman.
76 miles an hour, Smitty. That's the top that we've seen that radar gun hit.
Well, one of the keys, Jess, is look how far she gets out. She's really extended. And this ball, the way it comes out, almost looks like a screwball. It's running away from Jada Coleman, and you can see that Coleman just kind of whiffs through it. Big pitch on 3-2 to first strikeout.
Her last start was against Alabama in the SEC tournament semifinals. She did not record an out, really struggled with the walks. So a much better start for her with the strikeout, and Jennings will be aboard here with an infield hit. That was to her old teammate Mackenzie Donahue, the starter at short today.
Donahue trying to go back up the middle, realizes that she's not going to get it unless she goes down. And with the speed of Jennings, there's no way she's going to get it.
She got jammed on that.
Yeah.
It just shows how strong Tiare Jennings is. That was in on her hands.
So that'll bring up Haley Lee, the transfer from Texas A&M. 14 home runs, 51 runs batted in, and that was in on the hands as well. 1-0. Oh, well, they're going to say she actually took a swing at it.
She did. She tried to move with her body, but her hands and bat came around. She knows it.
Hate it when that happens. When you're like trying to get away and your hands are still going early. And that's the elite changeup that Pickens has.
Now watch Tierney Jennings. Not only does she get jammed, it actually hits twice. Have you seen this before? So it hits on her hands and then hits the barrel, which actually would be a dead ball.
Yeah, should have been. Should have been recorded as a double hit, and it should have been brought back.
I saw it hit her hands, and I was shocked at how hard it went. It's because she had two hits in one and ended up actually getting to the barrel. She knows it, too. She's like, that was crazy. I'm not going to tell anybody.
Yeah. Here's the 0-2 from Pickens. Now, we saw Tennessee in the Super Regionals, and then talking again with Karen Weekly before the World Series, she really liked how Pickens mentally had put all the rough outings in the rearview mirror. Said she was hungry to get back out there and throw, and not lacking in confidence at all as Lee check swings out to center field, and Malloy is there. She tries to Bo Jackson it back into first base, and Jennings dives in safely. Two down.
Well, the key for Carlin Pickens is going to be that changeup. She does have an elite changeup with that elite speed, and if she can control both of those, pound the zone at 70-plus miles an hour, and then float that changeup in at about 58 miles an hour, it's tough to really see pitches and get extended on her.
76. I don't know if the radar gun is juiced, but we haven't seen numbers like this before.
Those are big numbers out of the hand.
So. I feel like she's going to hit 80. See her first 80-mile-an-hour pitch.
Out of Weaverville, North Carolina. Where she was a three-sport standout, not just in softball. So multifaceted athlete.
Those are close to being strikes, too, Smitty.
Absolutely. That's why Koutsianopoulos is turning around asking the umpire, like, where are those missing? Some of the umpires will say, hey, that's a little low. It's a little in.
This is Sydney Sanders. And that pitch got away from Pickens, and Jennings will take second base. So just like Tennessee had a chance in the first inning, Oklahoma's got one as well.
Koutsianopoulos coming out to talk with Pickens a little bit to figure out what this is. It's hard to, that's her changeup, and so she's just holding on to it too long. You know, typically she controls it. I think she starts to think too much about that pitch, starts to steer it, hangs on to it a little bit too long, and floats it, air mails it.
I've seen her give that pitch away, and I think she has to concentrate and make sure.
And that one's in the dirt, and it gets away from Julia again. So Jennings will head over to third base, and Sanders will walk to first. Wild pitches of the season for Pickens. And here comes Alyssa Brito. 474 in the NCAA tournament with four home runs, and that catcher right behind her, her best buddy growing up in Southern California. Koutsianopoulos, who started out at Arizona, played in the World Series, and then transferred to Tennessee. And they meet again on opposite sides. Brito originally started out at Oregon. And as you can tell, both these clubs have hit the portal and done well for themselves. There's Patty Gasso down in that third base box.
is starting to hit Carlin Pickens right now.
Starting to play with her time too. Stepping in and out of the box, making her wait. Oklahoma's very good at that. You'll see they'll take their time in between pitches. They'll walk away from the box. They'll come back in.
She just told the umpire, too, I need time. Making sure that he understands her routine. Because she puts one foot in the box. But that's part of her routine. And Carlin Pickens took it as, all right, you're ready to go.
Fouls off the 1-1 pitch.
Yeah.
She's talking to him again. But this is also why we need a pitch clock in our game, because it's not just the pitchers, it's not just the sign coming in, it's the hitters as well. When the hitters take too much time to get in the box, it just goes both ways.
Yeah, if you've been watching baseball and the success of the pitch timer, we hope that the rules committee will be making that move this offseason. They have an opportunity to do that, and the coaches get on board. And that makes it easier to understand for all parties. The pitchers, the batters, the umpires, the coaches that are sending in the signals from the dugout.
Well, and sometimes you can't have your routine. I mean, that's
exactly
that's the point.
Is you adjust it?
She right now is saying, this is what I do. I need you to give me time. And Carlin Pickens is like, you got to put in the box. I'm ready to go.
Ball. Runner goes Sanders from first. She'll take second uncontested. Two now in scoring position for Brito. Fouls that one off.
That was a great location too against these right-handed hitters. A lot of times the question is, how do you beat Oklahoma? And every hitter is different. But these right-handed batters, if you can get in and up on their hands, and it is hard for a pitcher to be able to locate that pitch. Carlin Pickens right now is doing just that to Alyssa Brito. She keeps getting jammed and fouling them off.
Well, that's what Nyjah Kennedy did for Stanford. That's why she had 7 strikeouts.
Goes there again and foul. Yeah, they're so good, too, with runners in scoring position. And 40% of their runs on the season have come with 2 outs.
You just can't go low and in. The difference is up and in. You got to get to their hands. And that last one, almost a huge mistake. Pickens missed down, even though it was in. Burrito's backing off the plate.
Come on, that to me is a strike.
Right down the middle.
Wow.
Full count.
It was down the
middle. I don't blame Karen Weekly for asking where this pitch is. This is a changeup. And that.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
That's the pitch in the rule book. And instead, it's ball 4 to load the bases. Is that one pitch going to affect the outcome here this first inning? And Karen Weekly wants to chat, as she should. With one there, let's not let it get any further. And the bases are loaded with Kinzie Hansen coming up. Kinzie was the star of their super regional win over Clemson when they were down 3 runs and down to their final strike in the 7th inning. And she hit a towering 3-run home run. The Sooners would go on to win in extra innings. That is one of 3 victories during this 49-game winning streak where they had to win it in their final at-bat. They also did it once to Texas and once to Oklahoma State. Those have been the biggest threats to their NCAA record streak. And now the bases loaded for Hansen.
She was sitting on that pitch, too. She came in and literally was looking for inside. What we've seen from Carly Hansen, Carly Pickens, everything has been inside. This is exactly what Kinzie did. So she blew it right by her.
And she stepped back off the plate now.
Hanson ground ball to second over the first, and Tennessee is able to work out of it. Destiny Rodriguez with the play.
Score to be broken, but we want trophies. We're chasing trophies. Those last forever, and it all started right here. She would come here to this very field and sit right behind home plate 30 years ago. She was the head coach at a junior college, Long Beach City College. And she said, one day, I want that to be me. She said, you know, it's just like some of the girls that come here and dream of playing on the field. I was a junior college coach that dreamt of coaching on the field. Here she is. She took a leap with a $42,000 job at Oklahoma. And now she has built one of the great dynasties in all of sports. What a journey for Patty Gasso and the Oklahoma Sooners.
Yeah, hunting a sixth championship in 10 years. They have played in the finals five of the last six seasons and won it the last 2 years.
Oh, it's coming in. Oh, I knew it. He's gonna get it. You guys ran away. You ran away again.
It was a line drive.
Kinsey Hansen wants it back, I think.
Throw it to a fan. Oh, you should keep it. I guess you only keep it if you catch it.
All right, good throw back in, BMO.
It hit your monitor.
Thank you. Yeah. I took my monitor.
If you don't have a glove, you don't catch a line drive.
Yeah. I told you eventually we were going to get one.
Am I going to get billed for that?
Nailed you.
This is Mackenzie Donahue. They call her Lou. Oh, they want to send it back to us. Lou is famous in these parts for the World Series a couple of years ago when she was an Oklahoma Sooner and hit three home runs and drove in 10 for the champs that year. But then the following season was out of the lineup and wanted an opportunity to play elsewhere and found a second home at Tennessee. O2 from ball. Well, getting back to what Holly was saying, you know, Oklahoma is not for everybody. It is competitive, it is fiery, it is passionate. You are fighting for your job every day. That's how they want it to be. And that's one of the reasons why they've been so good over the years. Everything, they keep score. There are winners and losers. And it's created tremendous depth here.
Well, Patty's even talked about the fact, actually, what Patty first saw her in high school was a left fielder. Now she's playing shortstop for Tennessee.
Out of Mustang, Oklahoma. Popped it up, Brito under it. One down.
I think it also shows you Oklahoma's bench. I mean, they have a whole roster on their bench that doesn't start, that could be starting at other Division I schools, and that was an example of Mackenzie Donahue.
Number 19.
Well, and when you look at their lineup, Oklahoma, they've got the five double-digit home run hitters, but they have four hitters that are over 400. Eight of their nine hit over 320. I mean, the numbers are staggering for this Oklahoma team, so the practices, and that's what Patty says. She wants to work them harder, more competitively in practice so that the games feel easy.
They compete with each other.
Yeah.
You gotta earn a spot on that field.
One down here for Jameson Brackenbro, one of the emerging stars for the Lady Vols, the freshman out of Locust Grove, Georgia. Batting average is actually up over 50 points in the postseason. And she hit a two-run home run the other day against Alabama in a 10-5 win. It's the most runs that Tennessee has ever scored in a World Series game. That's kind of the give and take of this ball game. These are the two top scoring teams in the country, and their pitching staffs are both top five in the country. Backhanded by Ball, two down.
Three ball is like a cat out there. I mean, she pounces around and is very aggressive in that circle. But look at the way that she's going to go back and get this. So after releasing, look at where her glove is. It's always in front of her body. She's able to react. And that's what's so important for pitchers. You have to land in a good position to become a good defender. And Jordy Ball is able to do just that.
What Beth looked like on that foul ball that came up here.
Yes.
Cat-like.
Well, that's because you were bailing out of the
way. Yeah, I was like.
I didn't see either of your reaction because I closed my eyes at that point. Two down. And that one back on the grass. Six in a row retired now by Jordy Ball for winner's bracket Saturday. And look at this, Oklahoma. The home runs they hit and then the home runs they allow from their pitching staff. And Tennessee, a similar story. Mm-hmm. They hit a lot of home runs led by Keke Malloy, and their pitchers do not give up many. In fact, these two teams in their 12 games so far combined have only given up two home runs each.
Well, and that's really the name of the game. You got to keep the ball in the park when you're on defense and figure out some way to get it out of the park or in the gaps when you're on offense. Especially in situations where you've got runners on base. Let's talk about situational hitting and how important it is this time of year. Two outs, two strikes, wrist, runners on.
Carlin Pickens facing 8-9 and then the top for Oklahoma after she was able to work out of a bases-loaded jam in the first. For the SEC regular season and tournament champs, they are back in the World Series after an 8-year hiatus. The win the other day, their first in 10 years. That 2013 team that reached the championship series and lost in a couple of games to Oklahoma. They have been in the finals twice. They are here seeking their first national championship. Grace Lyons, the three-time Big 12 Defensive Player of the Year. Numbers at the plate are down a bit this season. And looking to heat up that bat again here in the tournament. She was 0-for-3 against Stanford a couple of days ago. Update brought to you by Enterprise. We've got the doubleheader today, winners bracket action. So OU Tennessee, and then tonight on ESPN, it's Florida State and Washington. The winners advance to the national semifinals on Monday. The losers will have to come back and play tomorrow. As Lyons draws the walk, the losers, by the way, cross over to the other side of the bracket. So the loser of this one would face Oklahoma State in an elimination game.
But it's the third free pass here. Around here in the game for Pickens. And that's a 3-2 changeup that she issues the walk on. Work hard to control that pitch, get it in the zone.
This is Elena Torres, another one of the transfers from Arizona State, hitting .444 so far in this NCAA tournament. Had a hit against Stanford. Big 12 champions for the 11th year in a row, but they have some moves coming up. They're moving to a brand new stadium next year. As you see, she did not check. And then in two springs, they will be making the move to the SEC. So they will be in the Southeastern Conference with Tennessee in a couple of seasons. Along with Texas, and a strikeout here for Pickens, one down.
Pickens get Elena Torres to chase this pitch. This is an 0-2 pitch, and you can see the way that she steps out to the left and the way the ball comes out of her hand. It's got a little bit of down, a little bit of inside movement. Elena Torres just can't catch up to it. Second strikeout of the game for Pickens.
I'll bring up the number 9 hitter, Riley Boone. And entering today the starting lineup for Oklahoma, just 214 against pitchers who throw some smoke. So that also goes into the thinking of Karen Weekly to start Pickens today.
Well, we've seen everything of the season from Pickens already early in this game. We can see the velocity. We can see why she's such a great pitcher, why Karen Weekly went to her, but we also see the struggle with command.
Yeah.
So she's balancing both right now.
Boone doesn't chase that one. One and two.
And we've talked to other pitchers, coaches around the SEC that have faced Pickens. Beth Tarina, Yolanda McRae with Arkansas. I mean, these are hitting coaches and coaches in general that said Pickens is the real deal. I mean, she is legit, 70 plus every pitch.
Two down and back to the top of the order.
Well, dialed in on that outer half. Riley Boone is going to see a couple of pitches that are 74 miles an hour on the outer half. You got to go for that pitch. Really good location. Great velocity. Second consecutive strikeout. Third of the game for Carlin Pickens.
The first of the game was Jada Coleman, who now will step back in. The Big 12 Player of the Year. Her first two seasons, Jada hit 17 home runs. This season, 16 home runs, and a pair of those in the NCAA tournament. And now, Megan Rhodes Smith, who works with the pitching staff, will come out and chat. All right, so Pickens getting a little pep talk and ready to go to face the top of this lineup again. Lions at first with a walk and then back-to-back strikeouts for Carlin.
Well, that's the changeup. So she's throwing 63 mile an hour changeup with that velocity at 73-74 miles an hour.
I think that's going to be the pitch for her, Smitty.
Yeah. Yeah, she can locate that if she can use it. She doesn't always have to throw for a strike, but she could pop that out of her hand. It's going to make that 74 feel like 84.
Well, just the way it surprises them. You can tell so far the changeup, nobody has wanted to bite on it.
Right back at Pickens, deflects it to Donahue, and nowhere to go with it. Hard hit ball and a couple on base for T.R.A. Jennings, who's led the team in runs batted in the last 2 years.
Pitch on the inner half, and it just gets bashed right back to Pickens. You can see her glove is down by her legs. She's going to be a little quicker getting that glove back up. She's upset with herself.
Well, it hit her glove.
Yeah.
If the glove was open, it would have gone right in.
Well, they had a chance with the bases loaded in the first. Now a couple on base with two outs here in the second. Jennings singled her first time up. She has been so clutch in her first three seasons at Oklahoma. Patty Gasso calls her clutch, 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 or clutch cube, if you will. And that might be why. Cube that home run, a three-run shot. And the Sooners jump in front.
T.R.A. Jennings is all about adjustments. She comes up to bat and she is so far off the plate, learning from that first inning at bat, knowing exactly how she wants to be set up. You can see how far, look at how far off the plate she is. So on the inside pitch, this distance right here is how she sets herself up to hit that pitch.
And the immediate reaction, knew it was gone.
has back to back off speed. I mean, that's what's impressive. Tiara Jennings wanted nothing to do with the off speed first pitch. They go back to it. Same location. You can't do it with a great hitter like Tiara Jennings.
Guys, and her first since April 23rd.
She's going to be mid-60s. She can work all zones. She also has a good changeup, which she's going to have to use, taking away that power that Oklahoma has so much of. 113 home runs now on the year. You've got to mix speeds and hit the edges.
Two outs, and the batter is the number three hitter, Haley Lee. Gloved by Pooney. Terrific backhand. And the throw to first to get her. That'll end the inning, but Tiara Jennings, they broke the old mark that Arizona set back in the late 90s. And now Oklahoma has four of the top five in history. And they also have a lead here on winner's bracket Saturday, 3-0 over Tennessee. On the Tiara Jennings three-run home run. 8-9 and the top coming around for Tennessee. Julia Kotsoyanopoulos to face Jordy Ball. Jordy gave up the leadoff double to Kiki Malloy and has since retired six straight.
Jordy Ball is just so good at hitting that arm side of the plate into righties, away to lefties, that rise ball, drop ball. She just loves to dominate on that corner. And the reason she can is she also has an outstanding changeup.
Julia fouls one back. She was also a member, by the way, of the 2020 Italian Olympic team. The softball returned to the Tokyo Games. Japan beating the USA for the gold medal this last time around. Up and in, and appeared to get the bill of the helmet. Oh, off of her hand.
Yeah, but then off the knob of the bat.
Oh, it's off the bat.
Thank goodness it hits like the ear.
Wow. Very fortunate. That's one of the reasons why I'm a proponent of the cage over just the chin flap. I mean, she's very lucky that did not hit her.
Centimeters.
And that is also obviously not a hit by pitch. That's a foul ball off the knob. So she will stay in the batter's box here. Oh. Oof. Man, now you got to try and collect yourself and step back in there.
Ball.
Step back in.
Yeah, I'm all right.
At a Mission Viejo, they have really embraced her leadership. She's one of the best athletes on the team, according to Karen Weekly. That's why they wanted her to catch.
Ball.
She's doing it for the first time because Karen told us we want the ball in her hands as much as possible.
Such a compliment. Left-handed catcher, right-handed hitter.
Yes.
Such a rarity. Jordy's so good at just controlling the strike zone, precision, accuracy with that rise ball, drop ball low in.
Look at that, 21 strikes out of 28 pitches. Strikeout number three, one down.
Jordy Ball's third strikeout. Again, going back to that rise ball. Look at the way she's going to get underneath it. Actually, this is a high drop ball. So it looks like it's going to be a rise ball, but you can see the over-the-top rotation on that pitch.
Let's check in with Holly Rowe.
Well, I am here with the part of the Mount Rushmore of Oklahoma softball. You're talking about the decade of dominance. So let's start with Kehlani. It's been 10 years since you won the national championship. What's it like to be out here watching Jordy Ball and the Sooners right now?
It's so special to see just how much the sport has grown, but also just how much the program has grown. And it's special to watch to see how much it's grown in 10 years. And, you know, it's an honor to be able to have these girls represent us alumni.
Jossie Allo, you have been one of the greats in the sport. You're still playing. What do you wish that these young women today know about the pressure that it's going to take to win a national championship? Because no one was under more pressure than you as you were chasing that home run record.
I think just to know that pressure is a privilege, and these girls know it. Coach preaches it all the time, and that it's a privilege to have the pressure on you, because it just means that you're doing something right and you're really freaking good. So
I love that as she's gesturing, the hand gestures, it's just this awkward bling of all the rings. Tell me the last thing. You're wearing the shirt "In Patty We Trust." What has been special about playing for Patty Gasso?
You know, she just cares for the players on and off the field, and she wants the best out of us every single day, and, you know, that's what helps us being able to grow outside of the program when we leave.
Well, it's a real testament, because everybody comes back, all of these famous alum along here. This is a real pleasure to see all of you. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Holly. Always great to see the former players return. We see it on the Tennessee side. We've seen it for all eight of the teams that were here. The former players love to come back, and often are the cheerleaders down in the front row. Here's Katie Taylor in the nine spot. By the way, Holly reporting that the three rings, one was a national championship ring, her dad has the other, and then the other two rings were both Big 12 championship bling. Oh, there you go.
Oh, I get too close. Yeah.
3-2 pitch. Taylor, slow roll to short. Lions, Chargers got it. Two down, and here we go now. Jordy Ball against Kiki Malloy in the All-American Showdown. 25 home runs on the year. To lead the country, she is one shy of the SEC single-season record. Doubled her first time up. It's the only hit of the day so far for Tennessee.
This is what you come for. Mm-hmm. Matchups, the best of the best. Ball versus Malloy.
Out of Woodinville, Washington. Her teammates say she is definitely the strong alpha. The Lady Vols want to follow her, and they have all season. In that leadoff spot in the lineup. Oh, that came in and hit her bat. Everybody clap your hands. Not just the home runs, but she walks a ton because pitchers are shying away from throwing to her. That's why she's got the most runs scored. She's on base. She steals bases. 39.
Yeah. So a walk is almost like a double.
Or a triple.
Yeah.
She has 6 home runs in her last 11 games, and her streak now is at 27 games in a row, make it 28, reaching base safely. Two and two.
Good job at getting rid of that changeup. That was the pitch she hit for a double. That one was more away.
Yeah, a little bit lower in the zone too. So the one that she did hit, mentioned, was a little bit elevated. Easier to identify, get your barrel to.
why this matchup is so good, because you'll see when Kiki Malloy gets in the batter's box, her front foot is open. She's a little bit off the plate. She can hit anything. When you look at, like, where do you pitch her, there's nowhere. But you have to switch it up, move it around. Right now we've seen in, we've seen away, we've seen off speed. You have to find that right spot.
Up and in, and she pops it up. Riley Boone calls for it and makes the catch. 9 in a row, retired by Jordy Ball. And he's in the final. Tiare Jennings with a 3-run home run here for the Sooners as we move to the bottom of the third. The winner of this one is into the national semifinals on Monday. The loser plays Oklahoma State tomorrow night. Beth Mowens, along with our Olympic gold medalist, Jessica Mendoza, Michelle Smith, our Hall of Fame reporter, Holly Rowe, down on the field with you. 8 teams showed up here, 6 remain. We have bid farewell to Alabama and Utah. And we will see a couple more head home tomorrow, the final 4 in the national semifinals on Monday. And the championship series, best 2 out of 3, begins Wednesday. Sydney Sanders through the 5-6 hole to lead things off here in the bottom of the third against Charlie Orsini.
Now heading for the Sooners, third baseman, number 33, Alyssa Morito.
And Sydney Sanders continues to swing a hot bat for the Sooners. Took her a while to settle in at Oklahoma after she transferred from ASU. Look at the jump the last 25 games. Holly?
Well, talking to Patty Gaslow before the game, she said she's really proud of Sydney Sanders. As the culture at Arizona State was just totally different. Their program here at OU just does things a different way. And Sydney Sanders, it wasn't easy when she first got there, just adapting, struggling. She wasn't always starting. And Patty was just saying, you know, I'm really proud of how she's handled everything. She was an All-American at Arizona State and came into our program, and it just wasn't simple. So really proud of what she's done and how she's growing in that Sooner jersey.
A top 3 freshman of the year. She broke the Arizona State record, 21 home runs, hit 425 last year. And you're right, Holly, and she's come on as of late. Of her 8 home runs, 3 have been hit in the postseason. She was the one bat in the lineup that Patty said, if we can get her going, we're going to be really good. And I was like, Patty, you're already really, really good.
If only Sydney would get
going, we could probably win some games.
Oh, my goodness. I chuckled when she actually said that, because I was like, wow.
Well, what a week for her. Her son, JT, is on the staff here, works with the hitters. And her other son, DJ, worked with the hitters at Utah. An assistant coach here at the World Series.
I also think one of the most underrated players in the country is the one up to bat right now, Alyssa Brito, because of all the attention I know Oklahoma gets as a whole. But if you focus on players, it's going to be Jordy Ball. It's going to be Jada Coleman, Tiara Jennings. When you look at Alyssa Brito's numbers, obviously in the tournament, 474.
She's their second best hitter in the postseason, Jess. Well,
and she leads them in home runs.
Yes, she leads them in home runs. Her isolated power, which is when you just focus on the difference between batting average and slug. Hers is the second highest here to Kiki Malloy. It's better than anyone else on this team.
Yeah. And you wouldn't think that when you kind of skim over the lineup for Oklahoma.
Sends that the opposite way. Katie Taylor back on the track, makes the catch. Sanders will tag and slide into second safe. That's a 198-foot sacrifice bunt.
It was like a rainbow.
To move the runner over.
Now betting catcher.
Well, it's another one of those productive outs, and that's one thing that Oklahoma is so good at. They give up the out, but they're always getting something from it. They're picking up an additional 60 feet or scoring a run. And that's why this is such a machine of an offense.
Here's Kinzie Hanson, a ground out in the first. She's the one that's hitting better than Brito. 500 in the postseason coming into the game today.
None bigger than the home run against Clemson, and what looked like was going to hold up that streak. Clemson was winning that game. One strike left.
She's 4 of 6 so far in the NCAA tournament. Risp.
senior out of Norco, California.
Keep that streak alive, tied it up. T.R. Jennings hit it with a solo shot in extras.
Well, one of the things, the other the aspects of this Oklahoma offense that makes them so good is they're great two-strike hitters, but they also are very good at identifying balls. They don't chase, even with two strikes, they don't chase pitches out of the zone. And that is a trait that a lot of softball players with two strikes chase over 50% balls out of the zone. Oklahoma does not do that. So that's why it's hard to find an out pitch against them.
Yeah, look at the amount of walks as opposed to strikeouts. Yep.
And that's why they can dig themselves out of an 0-2 count.
That is ripped towards the gap, and that will get out. Kinsey Hansen, two-run home run.
Please split screen the home run that we just showed from Clemson and the pitch location up and away. That is like Big X. Do not throw the pitch here. They go right back to that spot again. Two strike pitch, and it's the same location, that same spot. A lot of red zones for these hitters for Oklahoma, and that is one of them. Smitty, we're just talking about two strike hitting for this team and understanding with two strikes that this is the zone. They have so much power. We've seen Kinsey Hansen do it time and time again. Huge at bats. How about how quick this gets out of here?
In a hurry. Line drive over the wall.
Well, and the other thing too, guys, is how quickly they adjust, because I can't imagine they spent a ton of time in their game preparation preparing for the two pitchers they've seen today. Surprises that it's Pickens and Orsini, and now they will bring in a third different pitcher, and we'll be back in a moment. In the last inning, a three-run home run from T.R. Jennings. Those were off of Carlin Pickens and Charlie Orsini, and now the third pitcher of the day is Nicola Simpson. So for whatever reason, guys, there were no reports that anything was wrong with Ashley Rogers or Peyton Gottschall, who are respectively 19-1 and 16-1 on the season. But they have gone with three other pitchers in the ball game so far today. Again, this is winner's bracket double elimination.
Karen Weekly told Holly Rowe before the game, hey, we're going with Pickens as our starter, but we're going to use our entire staff. You're going to see pitchers you haven't seen in a while. So the part of the game plan, I think, was not to throw Ashley Rogers or Peyton Gottschall, at least not until late in this game.
But wouldn't you rather see those guys early so you're not down 5-0?
Yeah. Depends on if you're Oklahoma asking that question or not.
No, I'm asking
point,
for no. Tennessee fans.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, there's no reason to throw either of them now because they're
not. Not now.
So you got to, you know, keep your cards in your pocket at this point and hope you see them again in the champ series.
Yep. Because, again, the loser crosses over to the other side of the bracket.
Correct. So assuming that Oklahoma would get to the champ series, you know, that would be my guess. But you still have to get there. And on that bracket is Oklahoma State and Florida State.
And Washington. Yep. The next opponent would be Oklahoma State. So all a part of the interesting moves, the thought processes that go into the decisions that coaches here have to make. And, of course, right now, a lot of that is dependent upon, okay, well, how do we beat Oklahoma?
Yeah.
Now, they have lost games in each of the last 2 years here. And Washington actually did beat them twice at the World Series to knock them out in 2018, both during the opening round and the semis. If you try and get them in the champ series, you got to beat them 2 out of 3.
Yeah, and that's where I think it's hard, because you've got to have a lot of different arms, quality arms, to try to get through this lineup. You know, we talk about how good Oklahoma's pitching staff is, but, you know, their offense is almost like their third or fourth pitcher because of how many runs they put up.
And a strikeout there for Simpson. Wait, we've got a
ruling here by the home plate umpire.
He had his fist out before the pitch was even thrown.
I think it's an illegal pitch. So that's a ball, an illegal pitch, so it translates, I believe, to a walk.
Yeah, that's why they allowed the pitch, because if she had hit a home run, Oklahoma would have had the option to keep the home run.
So it's a delayed dead ball.
Yes. So it's a base runner here for Oklahoma with one out and already two runs in on the two-run home run from Kinzie Hansen. By the way, we will be interviewing both coaches in-game. Holly Rowe will take care of that for us. Coming up in the next inning for you. Wins leader in all of college softball. She is fifth all time. Been in Norman since 1995. Guiding the Sooner program. And as good as they've been the last few years, I mean, statistically, they, again, number one in the country, batting average, home runs, runs scored, ERA, shutouts, fielding percentage. And they played a very difficult schedule this year to prepare them, not only for this postseason, but for the imminent move to the SEC. They played, I think they're 6-0 against SEC teams this year during the 49-game winning streak, 21-0 against ranked teams.
Yeah, and to our point about how good their offense is, when you're scoring over 8 runs a game, you can have a pitching staff that gives up 4 or 5 runs a game. I mean, that's how good their hitters are.
Torres takes it the opposite way, and that'll send Lyons racing around to third. Runners on the corners for the Sooners.
You look at Alina Torres, look at her stance, it's closed. She's gonna step close and step towards the plate. This allows her to reach pitches away. So this is almost off the plate, and because of that stance, that's exactly what she's hunting. Didn't have it at first at bat. You could tell Oklahoma changes their stance, searches for pitches, even the bottom of the order, still getting it rolling for Oklahoma.
Riley Boone, the number 9 hitter. 7 of the other 8 in the lineup have reached base already today. Riley struck out her first time out. And again, no contest, allowing the base runner at first, Torres, to take second. This is the 11th appearance of the season for Nicola Simpson.
Simpson works mid-60s drop ball. She'll mix some speeds, but that last pitch, a drop ball on the outer half. Goes back to it. Right now she's got Riley Boone a little bit early.
This is a big moment for Nicola. This is just her 16th inning of work this year. One, two pitch. By 2 home runs today for Oklahoma. 46% of their scoring during the regular season off of home runs. It is up to 56% of their scoring in the postseason off of home runs. That's lifted out to left center, and the two outfielders confused, looking at one another, and neither one can get to it, and Riley Boone will drive in a pair Allie West's ball. Kiki Malloy, there's no way she's going to get to this. This is hit to left field. Little left center. Watch for Allie West. She doesn't get a good read and then just stops. Kiki Malloy was going to back up, never intending to catch this because she wasn't going to get to it. This is all the left fielder Riley West, and you can tell she's looking at Kiki, not expecting to catch it. That's her ball. Confusion drops in for another double, another score for Oklahoma.
Yeah, that ball has to be caught. I mean, it's still going to be a tag, a sacrifice fly, but that ball has to be caught.
At the plate for Oklahoma.
And those are the mistakes that Oklahoma forces teams to make, whether or not it's bad pitches or, you know, a routine fly that maybe you have to run into the gap that's very catchable. Just that intimidation factor. It's hard to be in the circle against them. We talked about the eight runs, you know, a game that they score. As a pitcher, you go out there, it feels like a daunting task to try to shut them down.
Well, it will certainly be one of the questions that will be asked post-game of Karen Wrigley. The decision to go with this pitching trio and not one of what you would consider their co-aces today, and perhaps it has had an effect on everybody, certainly falling behind now 7-0.
Peyton Gottschalk got to throw against Alabama. She got roughed up a little bit. Gave up, I believe it was 5 runs.
Prior to that, she had been spectacular. Yeah. And of course, Ashley Rogers, All-American season. One a grad student, one a senior. And now Jada Coleman, the top of the order, already 3 plate appearances in 3 innings. And now Tiare Jennings will come up, and this is what happened. One out, 2 on for Tiare, who has singled and homered. Been a member of the All Women's College World Series team each of the last 2 years. Last year, 5 home runs and 15 runs batted in to tie records. And Boone will come racing home, and that is the 8th run of the day for OU.
Simpson's going to dump this one down in the dirt. Koutianopoulos just unable to get in front of it. In fact, it almost hits Jennings, who has to scooch back out of the way. And Boone immediately sees it. Once it hits the ground, she's coming home with all that speed. 8th run of the game for the Sooners here in the 3rd.
When you look at Tiare Jennings and the home run spray chart, first of all, you're going to see she spreads it out, but she definitely likes to pull the ball for power. You'll see a lot of her doubles, her extra base hits, obviously her home runs there at 8. That's why she's off the plate, too. She knows she likes, they like to attack her in.
Jennings sprays that one out to right. Caught by Katie Taylor, and then the throw in. Jennings. Coleman heads up as the throw was a bit lazy, coming back into the infield, and she takes 3rd.
Oklahoma takes everything. You give them
a skosh a little bit, and they are going to capitalize. So this ball gets hit hard out to West. Coleman is biting. In other words, she's not going to go, but the second she sees that Riley West is not even making a throw and then pump. So here's the catch, and then there's the little bit of the throw.
Yeah, just the hesitation from Katie Taylor. I mean, that was everything. And Jada Coleman picked up on it. It's smart base running. Not just speed makes you a good base runner, but understanding situations, reading plays. That was a great read from Coleman.
Of the one seed, Oklahoma. 8-0 lead over Tennessee. Two outs here in the bottom of the third. Five runs have come in. There's still a base runner out at third. And Riley White is now the fourth different pitcher used by Tennessee.
Ball.
And it's another pass ball, and another run will score. Excuse me, a wild pitch gets Coleman in from third.
White's going to short hop this ball in, and Coleman. These Oklahoma runners, very disciplined. The second they see it in the dirt, they go.
Jocelyn Erickson, Malloy back on the track to make the catch.
Eddie Gasso for the Sooners, and there is just this contagious energy. Somebody gets on and it all cavalcades from there. How does that happen with this group?
I think we understand every game we play from postseason on is the biggest game of our season. And they just focus on that. They know what's important here to try to get after this game, gives you a day off, puts you in the semifinals. So you just put everything you have into it.
You've got great production in the circle from Jordy Ball. How do you continue to see her healthy this year impress you?
She has really gone to another gear since we've got into especially postseason. Not that she wasn't in fifth gear before, but if there is a sixth or seventh or eighth, is there a sixth gear? No.
There is now.
Sixth, seventh gear. She has found it. And everything she didn't get last year, I mean, she's feeling now. So it's fun to watch her.
Thank you, Coach.
Yeah, after playing through the forearm injury last postseason, Michelle, totally different look this year.
Yeah, she's attacking the zone. She loves to throw to all quadrants. She's really good with this changeup. She can hit the outer half with it. How about a drop ball that she can throw high? It looks like it's going to travel up, but it's not. It's going to come back down. And then, of course, she's got the rise ball. So she's going to tunnel that very well with that drop ball that goes down. The rise ball is going to explode up. Three strikeouts today. She's a swinging miss type pitcher. Not a lot of them today, just three, but she did have 22 swing and miss against Stanford with 11 Ks in that game.
It's hard to tunnel a rise and a drop. You hear a drop and a change, you can hear a rise and a curve be tunneled. Tunneling meaning they look the same,
right,
coming at you and then they break apart. But you saw there with that drop ball, how often do you see a drop that is pitched up in the zone like that?
Well, especially when you throw it two-seam.
Zeta Puti grounds it to Brito. Well, why is that one harder to tunnel?
Well, because normally a drop ball is going to be lower and it's going to be over top rotation. But when you throw a two-seam drop ball, it's going to have a non-traditional over-the-top spin. This is how a lot of Australian pitchers will throw that two-seam drop ball. But it just looks different, and then it's very hard to distinguish as it's coming at you, especially if you're throwing two and four seam rise ball. So just a lot of different ways that you can throw those pitches.
Zeta Puti after the ground out, one down. Here's Boot Gibson. That is now 10 in a row, retired by Jordy Ball after Kiki Malloy had the leadoff double to open up the game. Boot struck out on a rise ball, her first time up. Boo 263 so far in this NCAA tournament.
So that's more of a traditional drop, and that's why out of the hand, that clearly looks actually off-speed drop. Yep. It looks like it's going to go down, and as a hitter, that's not tunneled with a rise ball.
No.
Jordy Ball will throw her regular four-seam drop ball, and it's up in the zone.
It's a high drop,
exactly. Yes. And it looks like a rise ball, except it goes the other direction.
And that's really difficult to do unless you can throw with high velocity and a really good spin rate. So a lot of times we talk about spin speed, we talk about pitch speed.
So Michelle, we've got one of the greatest pitchers to ever sling it, so talk us through it, Smitty.
So this would be a four-seam drop ball, so I've got my four seams and I'm going to be over the top of it. This would be a two seam using just these two seams close together. But when Jordy Ball is throwing this pitch and it's rotating over the top, a rise ball is going to rotate under, but it's very difficult to see those as they're coming through. And when she throws that high drop ball, they're both in the same plane or the same tunnel, except one's going to go down and the other is going to explode up. So basically you have two different directions.
Show that tunnel again.
Yeah, so it's going to be here. It's going to be over
the top. Coming at the hitter.
Coming at the hitter. So that's your drop. This is your rise. So it's very difficult at times for the eye to be able to distinguish the backward rotation versus over top rotation. One's going to go down and one is going to cut up explosively.
And how close is it to you, Jess, as a hitter when you've got to decide, is this going up or down?
So that's the thing. Like, when you think about it, I always think about it from a hitter's point of view, and she's explaining it. But as a hitter, if you're seeing that tunnel, so you're literally seeing that same plane come at you. One's going here. I make that decision. Yeah. When she's here, I'm swinging, and now I don't know. Is that pitch going here or there? That's when tunneling works so well out of that same plane.
Yep.
And that's exactly what Jordy Ball's been doing.
And she continues to throw that on the same arm side of the plate, and that again is what makes it so effective. It's not like one's running to the outer half. She continues to hammer that inner half to righties, away to lefties, but in through that same tunnel, over the top rotation is going to go down, under is going up.
I don't like tunneling.
Pitchers love it. Well, I mean, that's really a pitcher. That's our job, is to get a hitter off balance, right? To get them thinking, okay, am I coming up, right? How am I trying to barrel up this ball? Or am I going to go down? Am I dropping my barrel down to go get it? And then, of course, you throw in the off-speed that she does so well.
Bradley Masuzan is the pinch runner at first. Gibson could re-enter after Boo Gibson reaches for the 22nd game in a row. Here's Riley West. Lady Vol fans will try and take heart if you think back to their Florida series middle of the year. What was it, a 7-run deficit that they faced? They rallied to win that. Much different environment here today. Ball. Because Jess, right, this is uncharted territory. They haven't lost many by a significant number.
Well, that's huge. I mean, I think that's why you're seeing some of the mistakes that are being made by Tennessee. Their biggest loss of the season was to Baylor, and that was 3 runs. Mm-hmm. 8-5 ball game. So when Oklahoma comes on, but there's a lot of players on the scene that never experienced this amount of offense on the other side.
Jen Rocha, the pitching coach, out to talk with Jordy Ball. More balls than strikes this inning for Jordy. She had a long wait after the 6-run third. Holly?
Well, the Oklahoma Sooners have been dominant all season long, and they've managed a very big roster. And I asked Patty Gasso, how have you done that? Why have you continued to succeed with this big group? And she said, well, it started out in October. We started out playing a series against each other. They had one squad play against each other, and it was televised, and it was like real games. She said, we were selling out the stadium every Wednesday in October, and that was like metal sharpening iron. You know, it was like, this is really good stuff. They are being competitive. And they are learning what we expect at Oklahoma softball, to be able to get out there and compete. They called it their battle series. It was on ESPN Plus. I was like, oh, geez, I need to go back and watch this, because it sounds like it was crazy competitive softball. But she thought that was a moment in the fall where this team came together, competing against each other.
Yeah, that competition every day. We see it in all the great sports dynasties. I mean, she's getting close. Another national championship. You're up there in Sharon Backus and Mike Candrea's neighborhood. You're Pat and Gino in basketball. You're Russ Rose in volleyball. I'm Anson Dorrance and what he's done at Carolina Soccer. That keeping score presented by Capital One. And the new pitcher is Alex Starocco. Transferred from Michigan on to face Mackenzie Donahue on in relief of Jordy Ball here in the fourth with two outs. Out of Frankfort, Illinois, 17-0 on the season. Has tried to battle through some issues her last few appearances. So this, Patty Gasso giving her a chance to right the ship a little bit. Four innings of work in her last three appearances. She's allowed six earned runs.
Well, you have a nine spot up on the board. I think this is the perfect time to get her a little experience, get her comfortable. She's a rise ball at the top of the zone. She can also throw it mid-thigh and down at the knees. So she'll throw it on three different planes. Good velocity.
The numbers for Jordy. 3 2/3, just the one hit. Kiki Malloy's double, that is it. And now Starocco comes on, who was an All-American at Michigan, Big Ten Pitcher of the Year. She also threw a no-hitter this season against Kentucky, so she's familiar with the SEC a little bit. She's also the one who Patty Gasso said was absolutely nails in their huge win over UCLA early in the season.
Yeah, she said it was her, quote, breakout game.
That's the only week this year they were not number one. They lost to Baylor, they lost the top spot to UCLA, and then they rocked the Bruins to get it right back.
Right back.
Donahue popped to third, her first time up. Sooners looking to go 2-0 and stay in the winner's bracket. Over the 40-year history of this tournament, that has been critical to your success in reaching the championship series, as well as winning the national championship. It has been a rarity for teams to come out of the loser's bracket, although it has happened a couple of times recently. It's only been done four times in 40 years. Look at that. 33 of the 39 champs have started 2-0.
With the new format, I think it'll be interesting to see if those percentages and numbers change at all. Obviously, a little bit more rest, a little more time for teams to be able to recover. Can you use just one pitcher a little bit more frequently coming out of the loser's bracket?
I think a lot of people thought that would be the route Tennessee would have gone today after Ashley Rogers and Peyton Gotchel both pitched in their first game here.
Yep.
Can go right back to those two, but they went in a different direction. And Oklahoma jumped on them. Jamison Brockenbro grounded back to the circle in the second inning. Flare to the left side, back on the grass as Grace Lyon side retired a couple of walks.
Coach, the score is what it is and the pitching's been what it's been. What went into those decisions about starting your two freshmen against a dangerous Oklahoma team?
You know, I like what Pickens can do. I like her variety of pitches, and that was really what went into it, was watching them and how they approach at bats. I knew it was a risk, and I take full responsibility for it.
Is Ashley Rogers, Peyton Gottschall, they're fine, and we can see them further on in this tournament?
Oh, yeah, yeah, there's no problem with them. They're good, yeah. And I think, you know, we've let things unravel a little bit behind them, but it all starts in the circle, no question.
All right, how do you regroup right here down to your final three outs?
We just talked about we don't want it. Today is the end of, you know, if this game ends like it does, we don't want it to be the end of our tournament. So I want these guys to play, to see as many pitches as possible, take advantage of every opportunity out there, whether you're throwing the pitch, you're seeing it at the plate, and get looks, because that's how you get better. You get looks and you make adjustments.
Thank you so much, Coach.
Thank you.
Thank you, Holly. Well, these were the two that were left in the dugout, Ashley Rogers and Peyton Gotchel. And again, it is double elimination format, so even if the score stays as is, Tennessee is back tomorrow night, but they are now one loss away from elimination. They would face Oklahoma State and then would have to play out of that side of the bracket, potentially Florida State and Washington. They are also over on that side right now. So Karen Weekly accepting responsibility for the risk that she took. And they will try and move forward with it. And Oklahoma will have a few more swings of the bat, and then the run rule would be in effect for Tennessee in the top of the fifth. Sooners, if they win this thing, they are into the national semifinals on Monday. And they would need to win just once Monday to get back to the championship series. That starts Wednesday, best 2 out of 3. Cool. Hard to believe it's our 18th season. And we go back to Michigan UCLA in 2005, the one that started it all. UCLA won game one. Under the old format, they would have been the champs. But best 2 out of 3, Michigan took games 2 and 3. They won the championship, the first team east of the Mississippi to win a title. And that really started the eastward trend, and great teams started to show up in the Southeast and the ACC and the Big 12. To the parity we now see and the talent spread out around the country, south and outside of Norman, where they have had a stranglehold at the top. 2 home runs today for their offense. That makes 20 for the tournament. 7 different Sooners have scored. 8 of the 9 in the lineup have reached base.
Shows you how balanced this lineup is. And we've talked a lot about the production of this team, but to me, it's the offense that stands out. And I know the ERA, the fielding percentage, so much, but they beat teams by not letting them get into a ball game because of how everyone can produce offensively.
Yeah, and they take advantage of all those free passes. So that's the 6th free pass today, 5 walks, a hit by pitch, of which 3 of those walks have come in to score. They're just capitalized. Take advantage.
Quincy Lilio is the pinch hitter here. Patty Gasso will get some other hitters, it looks like, into the ball game for some swings. The balance, nothing new, by the way, for this Oklahoma lineup. Look at the run production, the run scoring, the batting averages all spread out. 5 different players with double-digit home runs.
Oh, and if you look further down too, they've got 14 players with 15 plus runs, meaning they get players that come into games like Quincy and also produce. They have players off the bench that are not just coming in as pinch hitters. I mean, they can hit home runs, doubles.
And they're versatile. They can play multiple positions. I mean, the fifth, this is crazy, but the fifth hitter that is over 400 for Oklahoma is Jordy Ball. Now granted, she doesn't have a lot of at-bats, but still, she's got 13 hits in her 32 at-bats.
She would be hitting every game on any other team.
Yeah, for sure.
Lilio with Malloy getting to that one. They're gonna double up Sanders off of first.
She wasn't, I don't even think she was going on the pitch, so she's just a bad read. soon as this ball was hit, not stealing. As soon as it was hit, she thought this was going to drop down. Kiki Malloy's got speed, but this was definitely going to be caught no matter what. A rare mistake by Oklahoma base runners. Gonna get another pitch hitter here, Sophia Nugent. Sophia 279 on the season, 7 home runs, 23 runs batted in. And this is where all that competition every day comes into play. You may only get 60 at-bats, you still hit 7 of them out of the park.
Yeah, it's impressive.
Still driving in runs.
Well, because they know they're next in turn.
Yep.
You know, and that's what a lot of these coaches talk about. You know, you got to work while you're waiting for your opportunities.
And there's 5 seniors in this lineup. Think about players like Riley Boone when she was a freshman and how she had to earn her way into this lineup. Now she's a senior. And
as you look at your bracket, too, by the way, as the score stands, Oklahoma into the semis, they would still have on their side of the bracket Stanford, and then the loser of our next game, Florida State Washington, would cross over, and that would also be a potential semifinal opponent. Loser of that one would meet Stanford Sunday. Oh, that Washington bus is a-rockin' again.
They're here.
There. Huskies.
Pac-12 started with 3. They've still got 2 here. Malloy back to the wall and robs the home run. Kiki Malloy pulls it back in. The run rule is in effect here for the Lady Vols.
Ball.
So they would need a couple of runs to extend this game. 7-8-9, and then back to the top. The Lady Vols would need to get somebody aboard for Kiki Malloy to come back to the plate. Bottom of this lineup, by the way, so far in the NCAA tournament has been spectacular. They have not been aboard yet today, but through their first 6 games, 20 hits, 14 runs, and 15 runs batted in. And Destiny Rodriguez, who replaced Lair Boutte out with the concussion at second base, has been dynamite. And it looks like Boutte may be coming up to take some swings. She has cleared the protocol, and she's in the on-deck circle. She is. Sophomore out of Riverside, California. First time this part of the order facing Alex Duraco, who came on to face a couple of batters in the 4th. Here's your starter, and on tap to win her 2nd game here at the Women's College World Series. Jordy, by the way, since that Baylor loss, the team's only loss of the season, she's going to be 14-0 in her last 16 starts at this stage. Good range by Jennings. One down.
Jennings just reads the ball so well off the bat, playing well up the middle. She goes into that 3-4 hole. Look where she's starting at, and she's just going to read this off the end of the bat. She's going to go get it. Great angle, using all of that dirt almost on the grass when she picks that up. Good throw at first.
And of course, they have set on and are in the midst of an NCAA record. As it stands, they are 2 outs away from a 50th consecutive win. Haven't lost in 104 days. And that was to Baylor. Here's Kirsten Deal, the freshman out of North Carolina. She will try and come on to get the final two outs and run rule Tennessee. Lair Boutte at the plate. Good for her and Tennessee to see her back out there picking up a bat. Missed a month earlier this year with foot and a concussion, and then concussed in practice earlier in this postseason. So not only do the Sooners get to swing the bats an awful lot, but they are going to get some experience here that may be valuable for them getting Starocco and Deal onto the field if they might need to call on them later on. Two down. Loser will play Oklahoma State Sunday night at 7 Eastern on ESPN2. The winner into the national semifinals on Monday. And is this another pitching change? It is. So we've played six games here at the World Series. We've already had a couple of run rules. Again, when you win your first two games at the World Series, a big leg up, 33 of the 39. That's 85% of the national champions started out 2-0. And the Oklahoma pitchers are looking for a second straight shutout here at the World Series. That would set a new school record with 34 on the year. And the run rule count would be up to 28.
Ball. And this would be what, their 50th win, so a 50-game winning streak. Is that correct?
Yeah. Total win would be 58.
58, yep. Right.
50 in the streak.
That sense.
Yeah. The best ever record, UCLA in 1992, was 54-2. So obviously right now, this team would be the best single season record. That 92 season, that was the undefeated season for Lisa Fernandez. She and Jenny Finch are the only two national championship winning pitchers that closed out their undefeated seasons by winning the final. Finch did it in 2001.
Pretty fitting. Those two would do it.
Mm-hmm. Katie Taylor draws the walk. And that'll give us another look at Kiki Malloy.
Nobody for the lady.
And that also means that if Kiki goes yard, that takes the run rule off the plate.
Well, and I think
that extends the game.
Softball fans get another chance to see the best hitter in the country, one of them. And you know, we've talked a lot about Oklahoma's offense, but Kiki Malloy, just star power. And we see it here in Oklahoma City all the time. See the conversation. Coaching staff, Chris Malvo, their hitting coach on the left there, talking to Kiki, but her numbers, I mean, she's the only player in Division I, you guys, that has a 650 or higher slug, 30 or more stolen bases. But it's not just 650. That's anyone else in the country is lower than that. She's at 950,
yeah,
with 39 stolen bases.
She has their only hit of the game in her first at-bat today.
At one point during the season, her slug was over 1,000. I mean, it was...
Yeah, her slug in the tournament at the start of the day was still 1,000.
Yeah. Impressive.
Oh.
Combination of mom and dad, and that's what's been cool, too, when you see Title IX start to affect so many of the athletes we seek, so many of the moms getting a lot of the credit for the athletic athleticism that these players have. Mom, a track star at the University of Washington. Her dad, 15 NFL seasons, so it's that power and speed combination.
Yep.
Super Bowl winner with the Patriots. An older sister who played here at the World Series. A couple of younger sisters, right?
They're yep.
I love playing the game.
Football dads that get four girls. All four
right.
play softball.
Swing and a miss. One and two, and now Tennessee down to its final strike.
Kiki likes to hunt those up.
I was going to say, I think she tried to tie it with one swing.
Yeah.
This would be a 9-run home run if I get this one.
They have not been run ruled all season.
Everybody clap your hands.
By Nugent behind the plate.
Remember, this is a good experience too for Nicole May to get in this game, for Alex Duraco to get in this game. They've struggled in the postseason.
Malloy grounds to Brito. Ball game. Oklahoma in devastating fashion. A 9-0 run rule win in the winner's bracket. Send a message to the rest of the field.
It all began with Tiare Jennings, too. I mean, the offensive, the just output that they put out. It's a close game. You can kind of see.